Yes, yes, yes. Mm. What's up, everybody? Mm. You feeling that? Mm. Are you feeling that Post Malone?
Mm-hmm. I don't want to die too young.
Yo, that's my new ish right there. Man, welcome to the show, Enuff.
Hello.
I don't even know what to say.
How do I beat Malik Yoba? I heard the show last week. I was like, this guy, he rap, he
Malik,
sang,
Malik
he act. He did Uncle Dom. He did.
Malik who? No, I'm just
Malik
kidding.
Yoba,
shout out to Malik. He was an awesome, awesome, awesome guest. I had so much fun with him. But we're going to have fun too.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is what you do.
That's what I do.
I'm nervous right now.
I was born for this.
I'm nervous. Like, let me make sure I don't, like, accidentally press any buttons.
Cut it out.
Welcome to the show, and thank you so much for being here. You have no idea how hype I am right now.
SourceLifeRadio.com, baby.
Yeah.
Call us up, 347-855-3308.
Yo, I need like a heavy hitters. Like, I need that right now. I need the drop.
Need the heavy hitter suckers drop?
Yeah, suckers. What's going on, though? How was your day?
Good. Long day. I mean, I just came off of BLS right now.
Did yeah.
a shift over there. I'm on Quake's house. Alongside Earthquake and Deja Vu on Tuesday and Thursdays. And
Saturdays.
And then earlier, I did my New At 2 show at the Hot 9-7. And
you're all over.
But I'm here, I'm glad I'm here with you. This is something special, you know, because it's all about you and me.
Word.
Right?
Shout out to you.
Well, shout out to you.
Thank you, man. How was your day?
It was good.
Yeah?
It was good.
Busy? It's raining?
Yeah, it's always busy, you know. But I'm glad to be here. I love the facilities.
Thank you.
I'm going to talk to the boss. Maybe I can get a shift up there.
Because it's Please.
Poppin'. It's
really?
Good. It's nice up here. It's nice.
Yeah?
You'd be surprised. Like,
you've been to other
there's
stations?
There's a lot of stations that look horrible.
Thank you.
And it's,
oh,
it's,
man.
It's really clean up here. So.
Rug is in the building as well. Rug, what mic are you
Rug,
on?
Rug, what's up, Rug?
I'm on 3.
You on 3.
Thanks. What up, Enuff?
I'm Peace. Feeling good, man. Thanks for having me, man.
Oh,
welcome
man.
To Source Life Radio, sir.
What thank an you. Honor, right?
Thank you.
It's such an honor to have you. You're such a pioneer. And I had people submit.
What does that mean?
That means you gained.
I mean, you did a lot.
I had my dad here as my first guest because my dad did Spanish radio and DR for years and years and years. So I'm like, Dad, you know, you're a legend and, you know, you put a lot of people on in DR and it's such an honor to have you as my first guest. And he goes, you're making me feel old right now. I'm like, but yeah.
I feel young still, though, man.
Don't you?
I mean, for me, I've been doing it, boy. I've been a fan of hip-hop since the very beginning. So as a child, I've got to witness it on record, you know, from the day one record with the Sugar Hill Gang until now. And I feel like I really haven't missed a beat.
Word.
You know what I'm saying? I've gone through so many different eras of it and watched it. And I've seen a lot of people come and go.
You've grown with it.
And yeah, and I feel like whenever it's all about the music, you know, there's shock jocks. There's people who... are in charge of incredible platforms and units, and they have record companies and this and that. And I've outlasted a lot of that stuff.
Yeah.
You know, I've seen some of it grow, some of it go away, some of it, you know, diminish. And even incredible DJs, when I first started, they're all gone. A lot of them are gone.
Right? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So to be here still is actually an honor. So
I was going to ask you that. That was actually one of my questions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the last couple of years, obviously, technology has taken over.
Yes.
Like, what are some of the changes that you've seen personally as a DJ?
Well, I mean, of course, you know, we come from the era of the cassette tape. Mm-hmm. And actually, even before that, my parents used to have these things called 8-tracks. And 8-tracks were like these big, humongous cartridges that you would just literally put in the system. And then it was cassettes and then CDs and... I mean, well, of course, vinyl and all that stuff, but just to see the format always change was just something weird. Cause we always had to get used to that.
Mm-hmm.
So, picture this: I bought Bob Marley, Marvin Gaye, Stevie Wonder, Michael Jackson, Biggie, Nas, Jay-Z, the greats, Lauryn Hill, Earth, Wind & Fire, some of Motown's greatest, you know, whatever. Over and over again, because my parents had it on cart, then we bought it on cassette, then we bought it on 45, then we bought it on 12 inches, then the albums, then we bought it on CD, and then we bought it again on iTunes.
Heavily invested
it's
in just, music.
It's like, and you know, and honestly, like those catalogs, you know, some of those, whether it's the Beatles, whether it's Michael Jackson, Stevie Wonder, those those are the records I'm talking about because mm-hmm. they're timeless pieces that you right. cannot actually, I don't think people could live without them.
Right. Oh, yeah.
You know, so that's my investment.
Let me ask you a question. Growing up, did you grow up, because you come from a Latino family, did mm-hmm. you grow up in the old school Latino, like Spanish music, or did you grow up in old school, R&B and,
both.
Yeah?
It was literally split down the middle. My dad was the salsero, in the house.
The salsero.
And he always had, the incredible Fania collection on mm-hmm, deck. Mm-hmm. So I grew up with listening to Hector Lavoe, Willie Colon, Ray Barreto, Celia Cruz. Mm-hmm. Those were the staples at home. Mm-hmm. But my mom was more Billy Paul. It's funny because
Sugar Hill.
My mom was kind of like, it's crazy. She had, my dad was the Spanish, and then my mom was the soul. And I always thought that was interesting growing up. She loved the, but real like rhythm and blues, like mm-hmm. Billy Preston and of course Marvin Gaye and that kind of stuff. So those are the reason why I love those songs.
Wow. I have
it's
my
amazing.
Questions.
It's crazy. It's yeah. crazy.
Because I didn't have that influence early on. It wasn't until I was older that I was like, mm-hmm. oh, okay, Sugar Hill Gang. Because my parents yeah. are immigrants. They came from DR. They didn't know. Like, right. I wasn't, raised on that music. But right. I still appreciate it.
Well, both my parents were both born in Puerto Rico. And they moved here to New York City in the Lower East Side in the, 60s or something like that, mm-hmm. 70s. But, growing up in this beautiful, rotten apple that we live in, we always try to assimilate. We always try to adjust. We always try to, I know me personally and us being Latino back in those days, you had to kind of like, you wanted to fit in. Mm-hmm. You wanted to be, as Americanized as possible.
Right.
And even though our parents were very, traditional and don't forget your roots and this is where you come from mm-hmm. and that kind of stuff. But my parents only spoke to me in English my whole entire, life growing up. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't like I had to go to some like special ed class or, nothing like that. But the music was just like incredible. Now my grandmother, she's different. She's like, why are you playing this music?
Do
not
a hip-hop.
Yeah, what is this? What is this hip-hop stuff?
Right.
Why are you not playing salsa?
Like every parent.
Why are you not playing, bachata or merengue?
As a youngster, did you have a hard time identifying with your Latino?
No, not really. Because for me, even if I didn't understand the actual message in the music or if I didn't understand, like, my brothers and sisters talking, mm-hmm. it was just a feel, assimilation. Like, you just... whether it was food and music and I think I understand more than I actually claim I do. Mm-hmm. I think, my grandmother always spoke to me in Spanish and she still does. And I always answered in English, so it was that kind of thing. So I understand it, but I would just be.
You still respond
in English.
In English.
Yeah. So
con esa cara de plátano.
Exactly. Just like that.
Mm-hmm. Yes, a plátano face.
Exactly. But that's. But I think in the long run, that's what helped me survive the race because I always wanted to be sanctioned by the black people, mm-hmm. if that makes any sense, because they were the founders of rap and hip hop and mm-hmm. and even though Latinos were there also, because I'm very clear on that.
Yeah.
But it's mm-hmm. like they had the dominance of it. Mm-hmm. what I'm saying? Where we, back in our days coming up, it was like all the Spanish kids are doing graffiti, mm-hmm. all the Spanish kids are breakdancing. And then all the black kids are rapping, mm-hmm. And that's stereotypical. I'm going to say that it is because it's not everybody because we had Latino rappers who were doing their thing, but it was just the majority. So if I had to put a number out there, it was always 70-30
right.
in
right.
my eyes.
Right.
That's
right.
what it was at the time.
Right. At that yeah. time. Right. So for me, it was always just like, I didn't want people looking at me like, because our stereotypes growing up was like, oh, he's Puerto Rican, he wears black pointy shoes, but he kills.
he don't
kills,
have no socks
he kills,
on.
He kills cockroaches in the corner with the pointy shoes that he got up, right? on. That's, and that's the, and then, all my black friends growing up like, mira, 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 mira.
Mira, mira, mira.
And that's That's how we grew up here in the city.
That was the essence, though. Like, you don't have that anymore.
Jose.
Papi,
my name is not Jose. Jose. All the girls, Maria. You know.
All the girls are Maria.
Yeah, that's how it was.
Oh, man. You just took me back a little bit. Damn. That's so many questions. You know, when did you know that you wanted to start DJing? I mean, you too. I mean, because it's not like you.
I think the first time I heard Planet Rock by Africa Mambaataa and the Soul Sonic Force, my dad had a stereo set, and it was actually his record. And, you know, my dad was very strict with, like, the equipment at home. Like, don't touch my turntable.
Right.
Don't touch the equipment. You know, but after school, I'd go home and put that turntable on. And when I heard that Soul Sonic Force and the Planet Rock, I lost my mind. Like, I was just listening to it over and over and over and over, like, to the point where I didn't even do my homework. Like, I just listened to it.
Well, yeah, that's what I was going to ask you.
And it was those things.
How do you know you want to get on the turntable?
Well, I didn't know I want to get on the turntables until, I mean, I was always interested in it. You know, I got to see, like, Grandmaster Flash and Grand Wizard Theodore, and I've always heard about Kool Herc and the guys who founded, you know, hip-hop. And, but it wasn't until, I think, the success of Run DMC and Jam Master Jay is when I said, I want to be a DJ.
Wow.
Because I looked at their style. I looked at what they represented. The gold chain, the black suits, the hats, the Adidas sweatsuits. Their style was by far totally different from the first generation of hip hoppers that came. You know, Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five used to wear leather pants with feathers and you know, they looked more like rock and roll cats.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
They were like
the Parliament.
Exactly. Like they had that George Clinton
funk era.
Funk look.
Yeah.
Right. And I couldn't assimilate to that. Right. I was like, I'm not wearing tight leather pants with cowboy boots and
sequins. You know,
and wearing like beaver hats with the sequins. Yeah, like they were really
with
out
the tail,
there. They were really out there. So that wasn't my thing. So when I saw Run DMC with the Adidas suits, which was something that was
more to home.
Like, yeah, I could wear that.
Right.
I could wear black Lees with the, you know, with the shell toes and
with no laces.
This is my style. This is us. I'm wearing this right now in junior high
that.
School. Yeah. So that's when I knew I wanted to become a DJ. So it was Jam Master Jay who put the print in my brain and was like, "You're gonna be a DJ, boy."
Nice. I mean, most people know you from Hot 97. How many years have you been at Hot 97?
Ooh, I got there in August of 1998.
Wow. So you're like a staple.
So I think it's like 17 years, something like that.
You've seen it all.
Maybe 18 years. Yeah.
You've seen it all.
I saw the birth of it. You know, my first taste of terrestrial radio was with 98.7 KISS FM.
Wow.
Red Alert gave me my first shot. This is when Funkmaster Flex left KISS FM. As Red Alert's protege to start a thing called Hot 97. And before Hot 97, you know, terrestrial radio only played hip-hop at night. You understand? So, you know, even though Hot 97 is very commercial and radio, you know, mainstream right now, but in its heyday when it first started, it was the first radio station to go 24 hours hip-hop. You know, so it was groundbreaking, especially, you know, being here from New York.
Yeah, because the only stations back in the day that was playing hip-hop was 98.7 and BLS added on and,
exactly.
And started playing.
Yeah, and there was wars. There was wars in between those, you know, back in those days, like Red Alert went against Marley Marl. Mm-hmm. So it was like Red Alert and the Violators versus Marley Marl and the Juice Crew. Right. And it was, you know, like program directors, you know, you know, you got to follow radio, but it was like Barry Mayo versus you know, Frankie Crocker. And, you know, there's a lot of online segments where you can follow these people if you guys don't know who these names are. But they were very instrumental in terrestrial radio. The first guys to break music. Like, I used to listen to WBLS back in the days because BLS was around way before KISS. And I remember in the 70s hearing Ray Barreto and some salsa on BLS.
Wow.
You know, and which proved to me that Frankie Crocker was in tune to the city. You know, he grew up in the inner cities and he saw in the Bronx or Brooklyn and Queens, it was very diverse. And if you think about it, we were all, you know, living in low-income housing, mm-hmm. and the soundtrack, you know, to that low-income housing was, you know, a little bit of hip. Well, actually, hip-hop wasn't even really out then, but, you know, it was like disco, R&B, classics, and Spanish music.
And Spanish music. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, since you're here, I wanted to kind of give some opportunities to some artists, because we have artists that come here all the time, you know, and the way you came here and you showed me love and you're here, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. I had some people send me music. They've been hitting me up. And, you know, I want to talk about some of the things that you do at Hot 97, WBLS. I want you to explain to these young artists what radio stations look for, what record labels look for, you know, okay. just to kind of inspire them.
So I could say one thing, just to set it off, right?
All right, because we have a lot of artists
when
listening
I get,
right now.
When I get records from individuals, mm-hmm. I don't care where they're from, I don't care what genre of music mm-hmm. or whatever it is, I always just keep this in mind. It's you versus Beyonce. Mm. It's you versus Alicia Keys. It's you versus Erykah Badu. It's you versus Drake.
Future.
It's you versus Future. It's you. It's, and if you put that into that, if you have them understand that, mm. that means that whatever you give me better be the best of you.
That's right.
Because you're going to go up against the best.
That's right.
So for you to stick out, there's something about your music, your track, your song, your lyrical content, your delivery needs to stick out so much that people are like, what the hell is that? Or who the hell is that? Mm-hmm. Or
just to, you know, catch the attention.
Exactly. And if that happens, then 9 out of 10 times, we could play the record on the radio.
Okay. So you guys are listening, right?
I'm gonna, that makes sense?
It makes perfect sense. And yep. I'm going to play a couple songs. We're going to, you know, come back. I'm just going to little snippets here and then, because I want to get you on the ones and twos. I mean.
Let's do it.
We got to do it.
This is what I do. Let's do it. We can take it however you want to do it.
I could
play music from my childhood all the way up to
whatever you want
to today.
All right, so we here. Enuff is here,
and I'm gonna give you a better one. How about this? Because I'm here with Whip a Whip. All right. if there's a song that I hear today, I'll play it on the new at 2.
Banga. You see?
Is that a fair deal?
Listen. You're the boss, all right? I'm just here playing. So we're going to set it off with Devontae Miles. He's a young cat from Brooklyn. He was up on the show. Talent. I love it.
Let's hear it. Come on,
Source Life Radio. We out.
Is that?
Yes.
Joseph Castro.
That's Joseph Castro from the Bronx.
And nice.
He's a young kid. He's like 17. Talented.
Got some good music.
Yeah, man. I got a couple, you know. Fat Poppy.
All right. This is. You want me to give you some.
Go ahead. They're listening.
All right. So. I think first and foremost, I think the songs are pretty good all across the board. They're mm-hmm. not bad. I just maybe think maybe a little bit of mixing, maybe the production needs to be a little bit better here mm-hmm. and there. Just, you know, it needs to be tweaked. You know, and I think they know what that means.
I think they know.
I think they have the foundation and the basis of what they want, and I think it's actually good. And personally, I just think it needs to be tweaked a little bit here and there.
What's that element though?
Or they could say, "Shut up, Enuff. We're going to do it this way." And it's totally cool.
Right. Because you do this.
I mean, I do this.
You do this.
I do.
You do this.
But they can. They have the absolute right to not care what
I
think.
Or like my son Ethan says, what does he say? I want to do this.
I want to do this.
I want to do this. You do this.
SourceLiveRadio.com.
Yo, if you guys want to call up, by the way, the number is 347-855-3308. 347-855-3308.
So common here. It's like real zen.
Yeah. All we need is some candles.
Yeah, it's crazy.
I like that you like it. Like, I love it.
Nah, it's cool.
We're going to talk. Because I want you on there. Like, I want to hear you, like.
Yeah.
Anybody you want to shout out? Like, tell people where they can find you.
Find me at DJ Enuff. DJ Enuff. Just Google it and a bunch of stuff will come up.
Do people hit you a lot? Like, yo, play my music.
All day long. All day. The only thing that bothers me.
Tell us.
Keep it real. The only thing that bothers me is. And this is what I have. You know, it's part of the game.
Mm-hmm.
I might post something related to like something personal, that like a victory of some sort. Mm-hmm. Maybe we completed some incredible task that just was just, you know, grueling, and we're in celebration, or I might be doing something with my
something
family.
Something personal.
Personal, like, yo, you know, boom.
We and have then a phone call.
Let's take it. But then, right?
Don't forget what you're going to say.
Yeah.
Source Life Radio, King S. Who's this?
Source Life.
This is Pat Scarsia.
Hey, Pat, your phone sounds crazy.
You sir? I care. Trust me, I care.
There you go.
Yeah. Oh no!
You know what? I think it's the weather. The weather outside is kind of tough. Yeah, it's tough.
Say something else.
But he said he cares. He did say something about he cares.
Yeah, Source Life cares.
You care, right, Pop?
Yeah, I care. I hear exactly what you're saying, Enuff, and you know, you're a pioneer, like they said, and I care.
Damn, it sucks that we can't really hear you that well.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I'll call back.
Try to call back.
Yeah, man. So go ahead. So you post something personal.
Yeah, and then, you know, right away it's like all my personal, you know, and all the comments are like, congratulations or victory this and yeah, yeah, yeah. And then, you know, some guy hits me with the, yo, go to my link, hear my song. You know,
like, what about my triumph?
I'm like, yeah, but what about the success? And, you know, if you're going to do it, maybe you should do it like that. Like, yo, congratulations on everything.
Right.
Blah, 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 blah.
You're going to get a whole bunch of congrats.
But when you get a chance.
Yes.
By the way, that's
the proper way to do it.
But we never get that.
By the way, I have a mixtape coming out, and exactly. Congratulations.
Everybody wants to shove a CD down your throat or a link.
Yeah, a link, USB, this, that.
Listen, I know what it's like to come
up. Is that part of the game now? We have to deal with that?
Listen, I was an artist once upon a time, and I know, you know, and it's so crazy. I haven't even posted it yet, but do you know who my guest is next week?
Who's that?
Because it's going to seem like I'm, like, kidnapping people from Hot 97, but I'm not. Mm-hmm. I just go back, like, 10 years with Kay Slay. He's my guest next
week. Kay Slay.
Yes.
Nice.
So, let me tell you, I'm going to talk about it. Let's take this call real quick, but he's my
the
guest.
Streets.
Once he found out that you were coming, out.
Yeah?
Shout out to Kay Slay. Source Life Radio, who's this?
Whip, how are you,
man? Hi. All right, much better.
Is that Patrick? Yeah.
Yes, Patch.
Patch. Hey, Patch, what's going on, man?
What's going on?
It's still choppy.
still choppy.
A little bit. But go ahead. Say what you want to say.
Yeah, man, I just want to give a shout out to Enuff and Whip and you know, Source Life Radio crew. You're doing a hell of a job. And you know, I appreciate, you know, you playing your special song, you know. But people like Enuff, you know.
Thank you, brother.
That's his artist, the 17-year-old that I was telling you about. So
nice.
Yeah, shout out to you guys. I see you guys working hard, and I love to show love back.
Yes, of course.
So
thank you.
And listen, you got the connection, you know, with Whip. So just keep bringing the music, man. And I'm sure we'll get something that we could blow up and promote all across all platforms.
Yeah, just keep working. Thank you for calling. Do. All right, Patch, you
no
be good.
Problem. All right, good night. Now.
Man, shout out to everybody in the Bronx,
The Bronx.
You DJ everywhere.
I get a lot of love in the Bronx.
Yeah?
People think I'm from the Bronx.
You look like El Bronx.
Why is that? Because I'm Latino? And a lot of people live in the Bronx? You see?
I think that's
stereotypical.
Generalizing. You were wearing those pointy shoes, I'm sure. You sure you didn't grow up on like Fordham or University?
Nah.
And Kingsbridge?
No.
You Brooklyn all day.
Well, Lower East Side first.
Okay.
Because that's where my parents, both of them are from.
Mm-hmm.
And then Brooklyn all day.
Yeah, all day.
Because after that, we moved to Brooklyn, and I've been there since.
Enuff. Can I ask you a question?
Of course. You can ask me anything you want.
Outside of New York, I know you DJ everywhere. What's the craziest place that you ever DJed?
I think New Year's Eve, Paris, France.
Wow.
And Switzerland. It was the same run. And I think I DJed for about 20,000 people under a tent. 10,000 people each tent. I think Perrier water. I think back in those days, we're talking like late 90s. Mm-hmm. It was just incredible to go to a different country and for you to do your normal set. You know, you play the songs that you grew up loving. And
in
these kids, whether they're Japanese or French or, you know, Spanish, they know the lyrics to our songs. They appreciate the music.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, so the love for our craft and the love that, you know, that they have for what we do is just impeccable. So, you know, seeing those kids jump up and down.
Yeah.
Like, to our music, what we listen to.
Like, I'm talking about to the point where they're sweating and, you know, there's no cool factor. No one's popping bottles. No one's trying to be the man or whatever. Like, it's just about the music. Them spitting every single rhyme.
Right.
And they don't even speak English.
Right, right.
Wow. You know what I'm saying?
That's crazy.
So to me, those moments and during that era to me was everything.
Mm. Wow. Mm-hmm. Well, a little birdie named Saeed told me.
Shout out to Saeed.
Told me that you used to DJ for Biggie, which I didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, I know enough since Biggie. Tell me about that.
You didn't know I DJ?
I didn't. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I mean, Biggie had a bunch of DJs, you know, but I was the one that probably rocked with him the longest into the end. Biggie was an incredible, fun person. He spit gangster lyrics, but behind, you know, closed door, he was a teddy bear. He liked to snap on people. You know, he was one of them guys, like, if he had $500 in his pocket, and if Whip, you needed it, he'll give it to you.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? Like, he was that guy. I also gained, like, 75 pounds with him one summer because he would literally buy us food. Like, he just loved, he wanted the best.
He really spread love.
He spread love to Brooklyn Waste for real, for real. Like, we go to every city, and whether it was a restaurant or just ordering room service from every hotel, lobster, shrimp, chicken, steak, pasta, and, you know, juice and champagne. And it was just like, oh my God. It was like Thanksgiving every single day.
Big sound like somebody I could definitely hang out with, because I'm a skinny fat dude. I like to eat.
And I promise y'all, I gained 75 pounds that year. And it took me almost 10 years to lose like half of that.
Wow. Who else have you DJed for?
Queen Pen, you know, to be honest with you.
She's from Flatbush, right?
Well, she's from Crown Heights.
Okay.
Oh, East Flatbush. But I'll tell you a serious story that was a very important part of my life. When Biggie died, I almost died too. When I say almost died, because he was my source of income, but it was his story, and when he died, I don't want to say I had a feeling. It was almost like, I used to tell D-Rock, who used to roll with him, yo, watch him, man. Mm. Take care of him. You know, he was getting death threats. You know, it was too much, the war going back and forth, and then Pac died the year before, and it was just too much. It was just a lot of ignorance going on, and a lot of, you know, people getting extorted by you know, gangs and corrupt cops and a lot of craziness where I didn't want nothing to do with none of that stuff. I just wanted to play music.
Right.
So when he passed away, it was almost like I saw it coming and it broke my heart. Oh. You know, and I've had a bunch of people who passed away, family members, good friends, but his hurt the most. And I remember going into depression and literally like hanging out in like my local neighborhood park and drinking 40, smoking weed, just sitting on the floor. People were like, yo, get to work.
Like, where do you go from there, right?
I didn't want to go to work. Wow. I didn't want to do nothing. So I did that for 6 months. And then I got a phone call from a guy named Mark Pitts. Mark Pitts.
That was his manager, right?
Was his manager, along with Wayne Barrow. And, you know, they managed Usher and a few other people for many years. And they said, we'd like you to go back on tour. You know, Teddy Riley has a new artist called Queen Pen. And I was like, Queen Pen? Who the hell is Queen Pen?
Right.
You know, but this is me being honest, you know. And they were like, the money's not going to be as good as, you know, as big, but would you mind coming out? And I said, you know what? For you guys, I'll do it. I met her. I enjoyed her. I thought she was crazy. She's one of the craziest Brooklyn female rappers I've met in my life. Like, really, for real crazy. But love crazy. Make a long story short, me touring all over the world, you know, all over the country and the world with her, it got me to Summer Jam. And that year, Big Pun performed that Summer Jam. She performed that Summer Jam. I mean, we performed that Summer Jam.
Right.
And I got to, you know, not that I didn't meet, but I got to cross paths with the program director of Hot 97, who was always interested in having me up. And I was up a few times as a guest DJ, you know, during the mixed weekends.
Yeah.
And then when she saw me coming up the ramp with Queen Pan, she yelled at me. And she said, hey, you know, I'm not putting you on Hot 97 no more if you go on blah, 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 blah. Like, and I was like, why is she yelling at me? I was like, whatever. Mm-hmm. I said, if you want me, then you hire me. Like, on some, like, if you want me, then you have to hire me.
This
you have
is
to pay.
Business.
You got to pay for me.
What?
And then, you know, the next day I got a phone call. And then that was in June. And in August, I got hired.
Wow.
Crazy, right?
That's a dope story.
That's
but,
crazy.
No, but you see how sometimes, like, you're going through a slump. And you do it for somebody you love, you got to care for. And I believe that karma paid me back and gave me my destiny. You know?
Right.
So I've been there for damn near 20 years.
It's also crazy that these life events, you know, trigger these other events that goes on. It just show you that, you know, there's a light always at the end of the tunnel.
Exactly.
Man.
Exactly.
If you guys are just tuning in,
dope.
The one and only DJ Enuff is in the building sharing his story with us.
I feel honored to.
You go to work every day. Everybody's like, hey, what up? What up?
Yeah, man? Yeah. Hey, what up? I'm here.
Here we're like,
this is like.
Here we're like, the one and only.
we definitely appreciate you coming here, brother.
Of course.
No, thank you, man. Thank you.
So let me ask you this: what you're on every day? He's a beat maker too. Do you produce at all? Do you make beats?
Well, I made a few records. I made the Get Money remix for Junior Mafia and Biggie.
Yes.
I did.
What?
Yes.
I did. You're Nobody, Someone Kills You on the Life After Death album.
I didn't know these things.
I did some records for De La Soul.
Not this one though. Not this one.
Braxton's.
Not this one.
No,
you
remix.
Did the remix.
I did the one that goes, and if you don't stop, and we don't stop,
continuously to get money, you could be.
Biggie had my favorite verse on that track.
Yeah, all right, hold on. Let's. Call back 347-855-3308.
That verse that Biggie kicked
crazy,
on that beat.
Was
my favorite.
I'm gonna have to
Biggie
get that
verse.
Later. We're gonna have to play that. And you're gonna get on the mic. You're gonna get on the ones and twos. We have time.
It's already almost.
No,
the show's over.
Don't
no?
look. No, don't look at the time. We're having
my bad.
Fun. We're just chillaxing. But how do you keep up with everything? How do you keep up with?
Well, my job now is because I'm on the newer tour. I have a couple of assistants who help me, but we check our email boxes all the time, and then we go to these websites and make sure, you know, we have what we need to get. And then my job is, while I'm in transit, while I'm in my car, I take that USB key, pop it right into the thing, and I just have to listen to it.
You have to
listen
to
it. I don't even listen to the radio no more. I can't. I have no time.
That's what I'm saying. It's like you are the radio walking around. Like, you're walking around.
Yeah, I have no time. So, you know, I listen once in a while when I have to. I'm like, you know what? Let me listen to Flex today. Let me see what he's doing.
Right.
Or I listen to the competition also.
Mm-hmm.
And I listen to, you know, all other kinds of music. You know, so
yeah.
It's important. Because I need sanity and I need variety.
Balance.
I need balance. Very important.
Because I find it so hard these days with, you know, with Instagram and people posting and this and that. And you're like,
it's too much.
It's too much.
Mm-hmm.
It's like oversaturated. And I'm afraid that it's going to get worse. Like,
yeah.
As time goes on, you're just going to be like.
Well, even with all that being said and done, there's so much music. So many hidden gems. You know, Rory is a great artist at Atlanta. I want you guys to check out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, young kid, 19 years old. His perspective of life is totally different. He comes from a generation of kids who, he says, they know it all. You know why? Because all the information is right there on the internet.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? That's their
Basically.
Generation. So,
it's true.
There's, he got a couple of records with Big Crit, which I like. There's, who else do I really like?
You told me, too, that you also, like, lately you've been in the R&B mood.
I mean, I have. I've always been an R&B head. I thought R&B was always crazy, you know, because I'm a beast.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so if you sing a lullaby, you know, a lullaby to me,
I'm going
to fall
asleep.
Exactly. You know what I'm saying? But I do like going through the many emotions that music has.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? So if there's a person or a song that can bring the aggressiveness of rap, you know, out of me, I want that. If
mm-hmm.
there's somebody who would give me a sexy vibe that maybe, you know, I'm with my lady, we drinking, and, you know, hopefully I get some at the end of the night.
Hopefully.
Yeah, hopefully, because I make sure it's right. Or if I just want to be in a happy, good mood, like, today's a good day, you know, like, we got paid today, it's Friday, we're going to party after work, you know. It's just, I love being able to have that roller coaster ride, you know what I'm saying? So, unfortunately, there's only a few artists that always give us that,
mm-hmm.
but if not collectively, I got to collect it as singles,
mm-hmm.
you know, or hidden gems, you know, like Red Alert always taught me some of the hidden gems are literally on the album, and because everything is so single-driven or a moment in time on social media, a lot of people don't listen to albums in entirety as they used to.
Right.
You know, as a body of work. So with that being said, you know, I like the mixtape websites, the Dat Piffs and that kind of stuff, so that you could listen to, you know, a Diddy mixtape or a Rick Ross mixtape.
How do you, like, because you're in it. I feel like you're in the mix, right?
Mm-hmm.
What do you see versus, like, the new artists who are just like, bam, 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 right? That new trap
well,
stuff.
So,
versus
well,
what you're used to.
I don't know if there's, for me, it's, there's a time and place for everything.
Mm.
And I think, you know, for me, I can't turn up 24/7.
Right.
I don't have the energy. Now,
I might turn up and break something.
Now, I'm saying that because there's no way I could turn up 24/7. It's just too much. It's like,
yeah.
You know, that's just me.
Wait, do that again. Do that again.
I can't.
He's
you know,
just turning
look,
up right now.
Look at my dad. Look at my dad. Like, you know, but what makes me relevant is that I understand it.
Mm-hmm.
I respect it and I don't clown it. You
right.
know why? Because there's a 15-year-old or 14-year-old kid right now expressing themselves through music.
Exactly.
Or reacting to music the same way I reacted the first time I listened to hip-hop.
Right.
And I remember during those times, mom and dad weren't always so happy. Like, what the hell are you doing listening to this Public Enemy at 2 in the
right.
morning?
Right. Public Enemy.
Public Enemy at 2 in the morning. You yeah. know, what are you doing? You know, and they didn't understand the message. They didn't understand the noise of it.
Right.
And, you know, a lot of parents don't understand the nonsense with the noise and trap. But you got to respect it. You have to.
Yeah.
You have to. And you know what? It's fun.
It is fun.
No one's hurting nobody.
The energy from this music is great. I feel like back in the day, like the Public Enemy time, and that, you know, most of the stuff from the 90s was more lyric driven. Now, you have less metaphors,
mm-hmm.
you know, except for Fabulous, you know,
right.
guys like Fabulous, Jadakiss. And it's more energy driven,
mm-hmm.
the music. And it's more, you know, you're listening to the beats now mm-hmm. and the mm-hmm. trap music, and you're bouncing. It's more mm-hmm. of a bounce. It's not you're not sliding across the dance floor like back in the 90s, but, you know, it's a good energy.
I think it's coming back. I think a lot of it's coming back. When you hear, you know, like, I don't know if you heard the Eric Abadu record with Andre 3000. Andre spitting.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, the fact that he still spits and still
he's
does it.
He's always been a spitter.
Yeah, and you know, it's those guys are, to me, the staples. You know, they're almost like the pillars of the palace.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and once, you know, you have to make sure you support the building with the pillars. If the pillars aren't there, there's no foundation. It cracks, it crumbles, and it falls apart.
Right.
So there's always going to be somebody who, I don't want to say take their place, but it's going to be just as acceptable and just as charismatic with their lyrics as Fabulous is, or, you know, a Rakim, or a Biggie, or Jay-Z, or Nas, or Andre 3000, mm-hmm. or Eminem. You know, and they're out there. But
right.
because the time isn't that right now, they're hidden. So we have to find them,
mm-hmm.
you know, and expose them. And with platforms like this,
yeah.
you know, Source Life Radio, you know, we hope to, you know, expose some of those artists that you don't hear on terrestrial radio.
Yes.
Yeah, definitely want to give a platform for these up-and-coming artists.
Yes.
So much talent, right?
Yes.
Don't give up, guys.
Don't give up.
Don't give up.
That's right.